Today we have a really great dreamland. What's it about? Well, hold on to your hat. First thing we're going to do is we're going to watch a 2.5 minute trailer about a new documentary that is probably changing history. That's right. Changing history. Then we're going to be talking with Caroline Corey, who has been with us before for Superhuman. And this is going to be a super conversation about an amazing effort and an amazing breakthrough.
What has made mankind is an insatiable curiosity. Insatiable. What is that? Nobody knows. The phenomenon.
Nobody's ever done this, as far as I know.
It's a huge amount of work, a huge amount of data and equipment. That has never been done.
Whatever this is more complex than we could ever imagine.
This is a first in the field of ufology.
The variety of devices we're bringing as a team to study the phenomenon covered an entire spectrum of different technologies in real time.
That moment shook me to the core because I knew my life was about to change again.
I think we're going to have like a couple of really, really good spots.
When I hear that you've assembled a team of top scientists using state-of-the-art equipment, I say to myself, it's about time.
This is an unidentified, unclassified new phenomenon.
Wow, Tic Tacs. Navy Tic Tacs.
Maybe.
Caught on our cameras. Yep. That's incredible.
Crazy. It isn't crazy, it's crazy. It's crazy.
We can go from body heat to very cold, like about minus 62 Celsius or minus 80 Fahrenheit.
Wow.
We will be transmitting data up to 800 terahertz in frequency. Our highest technology is up around 500 gigahertz.
I can't tell you how much I'm looking forward to seeing what you've uncovered.
We're triangulating and converging at two points. The same object.
It's fading.
It's gone. It's friggin' gone.
Cross up to Nova Catalina. We need you up here.
We could be heading towards the biggest "see, I told you so" in history.
That's what we need, the smoking gun that'll clinch it. That once and for all will settle the debate. No ifs, ands, or buts. And in the process, rewrite all of human history.
You guys, is this the wormhole? It's insane.
This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there? In the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. I'd like to welcome Caroline Corey back to Dreamland. She was with us in 2020 for a remarkable piece of work, that a documentary, Superhuman. Now she's back with a knock your socks off burn them, throw them away. You have no further socks. This is called a tear in the sky. It is the end of something and the beginning of something new, truly in this world. Before we go on, let us know where we get this.
Hey, Whitley, so good to see you again.
Good to see you too.
Yes, we were just together also at the Conscious Life Expo, and I always enjoy you. People can just go to atearinthesky.com and they'll be able to get all the information there.
Great. And you will want to do this very badly, folks. I'm telling you, I watched this last night and I thought to myself, finally, it's that important. Now you ask, why is he going on like this about this film? All right, let's kind of tell a story here. At some point before you even started this, you realized that there was something missing. What was missing in the UFO?
Evidence. Data.
Evidence. Real data. Evidence.
Yes. Exactly. And more credibility because of the data, you know? So that's the big problem.
And you've known William Shatner and Michio Kaku both make appearances in the film and have wonderful things to say. I was surprised. William Shatner is a deep study in many respects. I mean, he comes across as, you know, Captain Kirk, and he was in that law comedy. I forgot what it was called. He was so good. He played Denny Crane in it. And, you know, he comes across as a relatively average sort of guy. I mean, you don't see huge depths there until he sits down with you. I thought it was a remarkable discussion that the two of you had.
Yeah, it was fascinating because, you know, this film was it's a scientific approach to the phenomenon. So we were trying to keep the conversation focused on science and validation and things like that. But he was more interested in the bigger story, in the deeper questions, the mysteries. We had amazing conversations, in the green room before we started. He's genuinely into the adventure of life and unraveling these mysteries. And so that's why when I would ask him a question, he would not just try to answer, okay, just literally, you know, the science is showing us this or whatever. He would always take it to this bigger, deeper level. So I really, really was very pleasantly surprised discussing that with him.
Well, yeah, he took it to quite a deep level. And before we go on into what you have accomplished, which is, it's the single most, I don't know how to put it. They went out and they did it. They did it. Big time. And now tell us a little bit about the team, and the equipment. Let's just start with the team. Who were the people working on this with you?
So originally, like you saw in my previous films, I wanted to include a scientific team who would come out and do the investigation, set up the investigation, like how do we go even about it, you know? And so I wanted that. And also, just because the whole story started with the Navy tic-tacs, as everybody knows, you know, the last couple of years, I wanted to potentially include that a little bit, but really the focus was on the scientists. But as I started searching, who are the scientists who are really open to not just be commenting here and there, but really going out and doing the work. And so in my research, I stumbled on this group actually that started out with Kevin Day. Kevin Day is the radar operator who first recorded and reported the Tic Tac video, the Navy Tic Tac video that leaked a couple of years ago. And so when I saw him, we had a conversation and he said, Caroline, I already have a team together and we already have a couple of scientists on board and we've been wanting to do this. And I said, oh, perfect. So let's team up and do this investigation together. And this is how the whole team came about. So,
Go ahead.
So it was a great balance of having the real people who were on the ship, USS Princeton, and the scientists that I was looking for. And also they happened to have somebody on board who ended up being extraordinary, who's David Mason, because he had a huge amount of instruments. And we're talking, you know, from the typical night vision goggles and all the way to like military grade, you know, cameras and instruments. So that was absolutely mind-blowing to have that all packaged in one team.
Kevin Day appeared on Dreamland on February the 4th of 2022. So he was with us recently. Now, tell us a little bit about the equipment.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Oh my God. I mean, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Well, it must have been, hundreds of thousands or even millions of dollars worth of phenomenal equipment.
Yes, it was about $650,000 because it was someone's property. It wasn't brand new. And so that's what I meant. Most of it, 99% of it was David Mason's. And so, of course, as we were setting up the investigation, the expedition, we had to have, you know, the typical cameras that people use, the night vision, but then we wanted to achieve, a larger spectrum. So we had FLIR cameras. As you know, the night vision is maybe 1 to 3 microns, and the FLIRs are like 13 microns. So it's a whole range of infrared spectrum. Also, we had spectrum analyzers that had different software and technology based on different technologies. We had magnetometers that were part of one system. We had radiation detectors. We had acoustic, the ability to pick up the acoustic patterns. We had radio frequency. I mean, we had everything and not just one of each. We had multiple, just the FLIR cameras, for example, instead of having one camera, because, you know, the camera has one field of view, you know? And so we had 8 to literally cover the entire sky. This is unheard of. Where have you seen this setup before, right, Whitley?
I've never. It's been a dream.
Exactly. And that's exactly the idea of this film, is what we see right now, all the footage that's being released on YouTube. You know, people have one camera. Usually there's or sometimes there's multiple witnesses, but it's always one angle. The footage is not very clear. We don't know. You see, so even though it appears as an anomaly, but if you want to do a scientific analysis of that anomaly, you have to have different devices, different correlations, you know, at the same time correlations across multiple instruments and devices, and also ultimately triangulation. You want to be able to see it from this perspective, but also from that other perspective at the same time. And so that's the reason why we had to set it up the way we did. And we did it.
Yeah, you sure did. I mean, the team is, it's an amazing group of people. Tell us a little bit about, you mentioned in general, it's always just with one camera. And like John Martin, who has been on Dreamland, he shoots with a single camera, with a low light camera, and he gets a lot of anomalies. Melinda Leslie in Sedona takes tours out to see them. But again, it's a one camera deal. It's not a scientific effort. Tell us the importance, for example, of triangulation, which you used.
Well, it's very important because you can record the object from different angles at the same time. So it tells us a lot about its shape, its distance, its velocity, and which you can't necessarily do when you're looking at it from just this one angle, especially when you don't have any other frame of reference. You know, it's just somewhere in the sky. And so that's the reason why triangulation is huge. And we had the opportunity to do different types of triangulation, which means that, you can have just two cameras within a mile away, and that's triangulation, even less if you want to. But what we were able to do, we had that option, but we also had the option of doing it from the Laguna side, and then from the Catalina side, you know, from way, you know, maybe 30 miles, I think.
Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Across. So we had different options of triangulation. And that's the reason why the problem with the footage that we see, which is incredible, I'm not judging, I'm just saying, if we want to go to the next level, the next step, you know, we can't just, you know, study these objects just from one camera and one angle. It's just not enough to convince the scientists, to convince the world. Right. That's the problem. And that's what I'm trying to do. You know, I'm trying to say, okay, I get it. You can argue this is this, or this is CGI, or this or that. But what do you have to say about all of these correlations, all of these instruments, all of these angles? You see, you can't argue that.
Now, the where will this go in terms of science? Because what you've done is at a very high level of finish scientifically. Now, is this going to be redone? Or are there going to be papers written out of this material? Were there any scientists involved who have access to the peer-reviewed press?
Yes. So because we had very hardcore scientists on the team, these aren't scientists who quickly will buy into something without a very rigorous analysis. So these guys, Matthew Shadagas and Kevin Knuth, they continue to investigate because we had hundreds of hours of data. They're going to continue analyzing more and more the data that we have and additional data, and publish a paper for peer review, which also is unheard of. I think that's a first.
I know it. It's just extraordinary because this is where we've needed to go.
Yes.
Ellen, when did you decide to do this? And how did that even come about? Because so many UFO people in the UFO field have assumed, oh, well, this is impossible. And you've done it.
Yeah, I mean, I usually, when I look at something, I want to focus on the solution rather than where we're stuck, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I originally was going to do the sequel of Superhuman because it had great success. People really needed this information 2 years ago. And then all of a sudden, I just had this inspiration, you know, it was like, no, do a UFO movie. And so the way you do films. And so it just came in, it was a little bit before Christmas, a couple of years ago. And by March, we had, as you know, in film, it takes a very long time to even be in pre-production to just lay out what is it that you're doing, who's in it, well, how do you go about it, and get all sorts of permitting and locations. I mean, it takes a long time. And between literally November, December, and March, we had the whole team together, the whole plan together. Everything was just, you know, the instruments, you know, the devices, the scientists, everything was ready to go. And we went out and did it in July. It's like, in terms of film production, it's also unheard of. I mean, it's especially that level of production. You saw yourself the quality. We had literally, what, like 10 cameras going on every day, because we had cameras on the people, on the object, on what we were seeing. And we were in three locations at the same time. So we had to have the cameras, different cameras. So it was a big production to plan. And yet it turned around so quickly. So I know it was somewhere, somehow divinely guided. There's no way I could have done it if it wasn't.
You know, let's get back briefly to Superhuman. Can you tell us, just so the listeners who don't know about that movie can know what it was and is?
Superhuman, again, takes on another paranormal subject, which is the subject of consciousness and the effect of intention, the effect of mind and consciousness over physical matter, the connection of the two together. And once again, we hear a lot about, yes, our thoughts affect our reality, our thoughts affect our stress level, so on and so forth. But in the film, I wanted to go the extra step and demonstrate how that is possible. So we set out to do multiple experiments on camera to demonstrate how, for example, remote viewing works, how telekinesis works, how you can move an object, how your thought pattern, your voice has a specific frequency that affects the geometry of your, you know, of energy field. So these, and also ultimately we showed how it was possible to reprogram the brain to be able to see completely blindfolded. People were ultimately able to see behind their heads, you know, be able to do also maneuver all sorts of things completely blindfolded. So that's what that film was about. Demonstrating live on camera the connection, the effect of consciousness over the physical world.
Now, I want to go back even a step farther now to what motivates you, because these are two real serious, groundbreaking films. This one is particularly important. I mean, it's conceivably, it's a historical document. This film, A Terror in the Sky, it's that important. What motivates you? What did you, when you started, when you first picked up a camera and thought, maybe this is my life, when was that? And what was that about?
Actually, it started a long time ago when I was a child. I would have these experiences spontaneously. Like, I would see subtle energy, I would see beings, I would communicate. And so it was a very spontaneous thing that got me interested in the mechanics of consciousness, of the mind. How is it possible that you could see things that nobody else could see? How is it possible that you can know of things before they happen and then it gets validated? So asking these questions since I was a kid and having validation. Okay, I can see what's on the other side of the wall, and then it is, or I know something and I hear it on the radio the next day, so on and so forth. So that whole subject was very, it was me. Like, it wasn't something outside of me that I learned. And so because of that, it was very organic to continue exploring all these fields that are all related, in my opinion. And having multiple types of experiences added to the kind of the impetus, you know, like the passion, you know, that this needs to be shared, especially working with hundreds of people from around the world doing regression therapy, just sharing all sorts of information. You go from, okay, I'm totally probably crazy, I'm making this up, to eventually saying, no, this is real. This is 100% the truth. Consciousness is fundamental, and we are entangled with the fabric of space-time. Science doesn't know how to explain it, but it doesn't mean it's not real. And so after teaching and facilitating for years and, you know, working with so many people, eventually I was convinced to get that to the next level, it had to be in a different format. Not everybody wants to do a workshop or read books. So I started making the films because I wanted to reach more of the mainstream and bring that component of the science to help with that. Basically, in a nutshell, I feel like my life purpose in terms of film is to make the paranormal normal.
Why did you? Now, let's get back to A Tear in the Sky. And yeah, you know, I always say there is no supernatural. There is a natural world, some parts of which we understand and some parts of which we don't. So, and that's why one of the reasons I remember saying those very words when we had our discussion about your film, your previous film. But now let's talk a little bit about why was it that you went specifically to the area of Catalina Island?
Yeah, so that was another important thing in the pre-production. We said, well, we know there are hot spots around the world. You know, we hear about people capturing UFOs in different areas. But so what it kind of, again, it organically kind of moved in that direction. The more we worked with the team, with Kevin Day and Gary Voorhees, we had three people from that ship, the USS Princeton, already on the team. And and so as they were telling their story, I was like, wait, this is the story, you know, the way it should have that real life human component. And so the more I'm writing the story, right? So the more, you know, they're telling the story, the more I realize the investigation needs to be connected to the story. And then sure enough, and that what happened was in the Catalina Channel. And sure enough, other ships later on also had similar experiences, similar experiences, the USS Omaha, the USS Kidd, exactly in the same area. So that added to the kind of the conviction that let's go back to where these guys started out their story and see if we can make it happen again.
So you basically, the idea was to go back to that particular place.
Yes.
You do know, or perhaps you don't, that a lot of close encounter witnesses believe that there is a base underwater out there.
Yes.
You know about that.
Yes.
And some of us live nearby for that reason, because we're not just guessing. And what do you think of that? I mean, do you think that you were observing craft coming in and out of an established base underwater somewhere?
Yeah, definitely. I don't know. So I feel like it's a combination of things, you know, and people ask, what do you think it is? It's not one thing. Some of it, I believe, is human made still. And it has to do with the, as you know, the base in San Diego.
Yeah, but the Navy, yeah. Base. Yes, right.
Exactly. But I also feel that, and this is more of the drone type objects that we see, But I also feel that some of the objects we have captured are definitely non-human. So it's not one thing that's happening in this area, which gets me to the next conclusion, so to speak. Some of the objects were not 100%, I mean, the things that you see there sometimes are light, but then they change form. Other than they behave strangely, they all do, but the way that they morph into different shapes, that's not human technology. And it's not an atmospheric event. Again, I'm coming at it from scientific analysis and things like that. So I think it's a combination of both, which still gets us to the question, why there? I believe, I don't know if I talked to you about that, Whitley, but I believe that the fabric of space-time is geometric. It's not random. Just like the physical body is geometric and has specific points, and we have specific energy points and meridians that circulate the energy. We also have an energy field. We also have a brain. Everything is geometric and patterned. And so to me, the Earth is also a living being, and it is geometric, it's a sphere. And therefore, its magnetic field, if you want to call it the energy field of the planet, is also not random, it is geometric. And so I ultimately figured out the algorithm of that space, the patterning of space itself. And I find specific nodes, the vertex points of this geometric pattern that seem to fall, basically it's the points where the magnetic field is kind of concentrated. It's like a knot. And so it seems to be that these nodes, these knots, is where we see the most activity. And so whether they already have been identified by our government to do whatever military exercise and this and that is one thing, but I'm 100% sure that extraterrestrial technology doesn't function like we do. It's not linear. They understand the fabric of space-time and know how to use it. And so they're not going to traverse space, in a linear way and spend hundreds of years to get here. It's ridiculous. They understand that these nodes are resonant basically with each other, coherent, so that you can simply, move your vehicle, your craft to these particular nodes instantaneously, bypassing time space. And so I believe that this is the type of technology they're using. And so that's why it ended up all being in those areas. And one of them is the Catalina Channel.
Yes. And I will ask an author. There is a paper in the public space, but still privately held. In other words, the author hasn't published it yet, that goes into this in great detail. And it's the only one in the public space I know of that is correct. And I'll ask him if he can send it to you. If I can send it to you, I know you'd be very interested in it.
Is it along the same line of the patterning of space-time?
Yes, exactly. Oh. It's precisely what you were discussing.
Oh, my God. Is it a scientific paper?
Yes, I would. It's a... he is a... I'm not sure of his title, but it's a very well done paper.
I mean, I've been looking for evidence. I have other people who have kind of confirmed a similar type thing, but not scientists. I want science. Yeah,
this is a serious guy, and
I would love that.
And I'm not sure of it. I didn't expect you to ask for his CV. But I understand why you did. I'm not sure of it, and I'm not sure of the degree. He's rather private about it, is what I'm saying. But I'll see if the two of you can get in touch. Now, the let's get back to what you found and accomplished, because there are moments in that film that are really remarkable. When, for example, the moment when the group of lights are in the cloud and they can be seen by one camera and another camera right beside it isn't seeing them.
Yes.
Can you tell about that? That is just...
Go figure. Yeah. So if that's not an anomaly, what is? The two cameras are functioning perfectly. Perfectly. I mean, you see, you know, and then we're observing an object and one camera, you could see it through the one camera, but you can't see it through the other. It's recording the exact same thing. How does that work? You see,
there's don't ask me the question,
right? So that's what I mean. And then this, the cameras, again, people who want to be skeptical, whatever, again, we're doing this scientifically. We know the first thing we look at, camera glitch. I mean, come on, you know, we're not going to put out information just for the sake of it, you know? So the first thing we look at, is it a camera glitch? Is it this, is it whatever? Is this, do we have control? You know, do we have this? Is the camera running before showing us something, after, so on and so forth? And that's why by the time we put it in the film, you know, it is an anomaly. So
it's a fascinating and important anomaly, too, because it implies an exquisite ability to control our ability to detect.
Yes.
You see? And you have to wonder where that comes from and why was it demonstrated to you? Because we're looking here through our own eyes at the ideas of people or beings who come from another culture of some sort, whether it's another culture from another planet or where it's from, we don't know. I wonder why they would choose to do that, because it's a done thing. It's not an accident, almost certainly.
Yeah, I don't think it's not on purpose. I think everything was on purpose. Even everything that we did capture was not the typical thing. Of course, we captured the typical orbs and things like that. But I believe that this film was made on purpose. I really don't think I did that on my own. And I'm not talking about the humans. I really think there was a purpose to give us a range of anomalies to, especially the last one in the film, for us to really, really stop and think. And I really think, like what you said, this is historic, because we are now bringing real credible scientists to tell on board to tell us it's technically impossible. Two identical cameras side by side. And so going back to your question, I think it's for us to really, they're using the film. That's my take on it. Okay. They're using the film because I am now reaching a different audience in a way, right? By integrating the science. So I think they're using the film to give us even more clues that go ahead.
They are communicating. That was a communication. That was, see, we can do this. Figure that out. You figure out why we can do this and how we did it. Because, Caroline, there is a whole lot of science that can be done as long as we accept that that was real. In other words, that the two cameras were identical and that they were working properly. Therefore, what was entering the two cameras, one not anything and the other an image, we can learn from that. I think you probably have on that film clues as to why the image would be visible in one camera and not in another. But they're not going to be obvious clues. They're going to be way down in the atomic structure of the image, way down that deep, I think, because there's something there that would be different from normal, or it would not be like that.
Exactly. So I feel like, are they giving us clues on the technology that's possible? Or to me, what is more fascinating, are they giving us clues on how the universe works? In other words,
that's very possible. And yeah, that could be
like
one of them.
How exactly, going back to the fabric of space-time,
right,
that, you know, you could do certain things in certain points in space because it's naturally possible. I like to look at that angle as well, not just, right, oh, they're advanced, they have these crafts and da, da, da. I mean, of course, that's fascinating.
That's old hat. Let's try it. I'm trying to have an interview at a new level too, try to really look into what is going on here and what kind of communication you received. Because an anomaly like that stands out as an exclamation point. It says, look at this.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and then of course the last thing is even more mind blowing. I mean, we want people to really watch the film to see how it all unfolds, but some of the other clues as well. For example, there is another object that appears out of nowhere, like on the camera. And then it's like flies for a few frames and then boop, disappears. So that's okay. We've seen that before, but it had a shape. It was very, and it's like tilting, it's doing all that stuff. And then it's registering cold, an object that,
its surface was cold.
Yes, it's cold. So if you're flying, you have a propulsion system, there's no way that's going to be cold. So it's a sort of technology that is not using our propulsion system. How are they doing that? How is that possible? And how does it appear and then just boom, disappear? There's no clouds, there's nothing, it's the same, you know. So all of these to me are fascinating clues, fascinating. Especially when you start to correlate them with radiation, different angles. You know, now the conversation is interesting.
Yeah, because you're beginning to be able to not only to see the objects, but to see something about them. One of them was unusually cold. Were they all like that?
No. So some of them were normal. They were just having a different behavior, like they were zigzagging or doing things like that. Some of them were going against the wind, but they weren't cold necessarily. So it was that's what I was saying. Like it was a range. I feel like they gave us samples.
Right. Well, the thing that's interesting is that to me, the ones that stand out are the ones that are maybe the most important words in the sentence that they read to you in the sentence in the sky, and that coldness of one of them. And I would wonder where it came from, what direction it came from, how long it was there, how it disappeared, all of those things to try to understand why it was different from the others. And then we get into the matter of technology, because energy generation, a side effect of it is heat. And magnetism is also very often a side effect of UFO activity. There's a high level of magnetism involved. Can you tell us a little bit about the various technologies that you used to measure, optical and what else? I know you even used acoustic technologies.
Yeah, and there's spectrum analyzer, so analyzing also radio frequencies and magnetometers, some of the magnetic field fluctuation radiation detection. detection. So there was that going on as well. And again, the range of the optical, like the different spectrum from the optical devices. So we had the CCD cameras, which is the normal camera. And then we had the night vision, the regular infrared, and then the FLIR. So just optical, we had a whole range.
What is FLIR?
FLIR are the thermal cameras. Right. And that basically, you know, the military use, you know, and so basically it's picking up the heat signature of the vehicle, of the object, but at a whole wide range. I mean, like I said, the typical night vision is, I think, 1.3 or something like that. I hope I'm not making a mistake, but it's a very small infrared range. So you're seeing in the infrared range, and the FLIR is like 13. So you're going into the infrared visual spectrum with one of these cameras, and we had 8 of them. So that this type of technology also, most UFO investigators don't have that, you know, this type of equipment available, and we did. So it was really extraordinary to have access to all of these and have correlations. Another very important thing is we want to correlate what we see exactly at 9:29, this weird object doing this and that or whatever. At the same time, we have a radiation that is totally a spike that is totally unusual. So then that correlation becomes interesting because was it caused by the object or is it a fluke? You know, you can always say it was a fluke. So the idea is then we go back to the radiation spike and study that. Okay, maybe it was a solar flare. Maybe it was some sort of other. So we check with other systems, you know, there are other systems that are constantly monitoring space for radiation, for this, for that. And so none of it checks out. So why did we have that particular spike exactly at the same time that this object appears? If it's not this, it's not that, it's not NASA, you know. So then you see what I mean? Now we are starting to have clues about the properties of these objects, that they can not only appear, disappear, or do crazy stuff, but they also could be accompanied with massive radiation spikes. And I'm talking massive. I mean, the normal radiation on Earth is about 2 MeV or something. And this was like 30, it was 40. It's very, very unusual. It's like 1 in 10,000, 1 in 100,000.
And what exactly was generating it? What did it look like?
It was a spike. What do you mean, the radiation?
No. What were you looking? I'm confused as to whether you were trained on an object when you got the radiation spike. I'm not quite sure where it came from.
So it's different devices doing different things.
Yeah. I know. But what was happening around you when the radiation spike occurred?
Around us physically, you mean?
Yeah.
Nothing. We were all trying.
Oh, so the radiation spike just came out of nowhere then.
Yeah, exactly. We were just there. And all of a sudden, like we have a line, all of a sudden, doot, doot, doot. You know, it's like, oh, what's going on here? And the system is analyzing, you know, what it was detecting. So we were just glued to what was happening. So some of us were observing the object. Others were looking at the spike, and then we put our notes together.
You mentioned in describing the equipment in the film that some of it is old, some of it is new, some of it is experimental. Now, and the basic older equipment would be the old night vision cameras, yeah, and so forth. And what would be the new equipment?
Yeah, so when I think Gary, oops, sorry. I think, I don't know how I turn everything off. I don't know how it still comes through. I think Gary said that. And what he meant by old doesn't mean like the equipment is old. It means
it's just not, old it's technology. Not,
yeah, 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 exactly. Yeah, yeah. It's like the regular cameras right. that everybody right. uses.
Right. And your brand new Mixmaster result.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Or right. the night vision. I mean, you can get that off the shelf, you know. So that's what he meant. The newer technology, and he said some of it is cutting edge. So experimental and cutting edge. So the FLIR cameras that I was talking about is also, I mean, it's not new, you know, the military uses FLIR technology, but it's new for us, for ufology. You know, I mean, that's totally new to have 8 FLIR cameras that can detect infrared. So that is totally new, but the cutting edge stuff, and also some of the radiation detection that Matthew Shadagas had, that was done by MIT, was designed by MIT to measure radiation in a new way. So that was kind of a new type of technology. And also the things that David Mason had, the invention that he had, this is totally cutting edge. These are inventions. And it's based on the idea that you can register, you can detect the light pattern around that the object is emitting. So if you capture the frequency or, you know, the signature of that light pattern, he created a technology as you're looking at it to transfer it into a sound. So basically you're hearing what you're seeing.
Right.
Yeah. And what's the point of that? First of all, it gives us clues. Oh, the light is this or that or whatever. But then with that sound wave, you can then also transfer it back. So, I mean, we could also transfer back the light, but he had it done this way and he had other things detecting the thermal signature of the object and transferring it back. So he had all this technology never seen before. These are inventions that we had that was very, very unique. It's very cutting edge, and it's certainly not used in ufology. So that's why we had a big advantage with some of the very cutting edge stuff in addition, you know, to the typical things.
And what did that advantage gain you? What did you get from the cutting edge stuff that you don't think you would have gotten otherwise?
Well, just the FLIR alone, again, the typical UFO investigators don't even have one FLIR, you know,
right.
We had, you know, each camera is about $50,000. So that was one thing that we had, and having 8 of them allowed us to cover the entire sky, basically. So, and also run everything 24/7 over 5 days. So that was a huge advantage. And,
yes.
You know, and the other things that we detected, I think these specific data correlations are still being investigated, because we ended up, Whitley, like with hundreds of hours. So imagine you saw how much equipment there was, and everything is running 24/7. So it's like, you know, 1 hour of footage is 216,000 frames, because we look at it frame by frame. Of course, some of the stuff is very obvious. You can see it's a bird or something. But when you stumble on something, like you look at it frame by frame. It's a huge amount of data to go through.
Yeah.
So some of the new cutting edge technology that we had is still being studied, how that correlated with something we saw and what it actually did.
I see. So it's an absolutely enormous task that you, and fortunately it is a task that is doable because of computers, because without the support of computers to identify imagery and all of those single still images, you would not be able to really get anywhere with it. Michio Kaku says a makes a trenchant comment at one point in the film, saying that we need to reach the level of this. I'm paraphrasing him, or even worse, remembering him, but not very clearly. But anyway, I'm trying, folks. He says that we have to get this to a point where the reality is undeniable scientifically. Now, when you take together the videos that has already been released by the government and what you did, because what you did takes another step, it seems fairly evident that someone was there for you. In other words, it would seem that there was a reaction, that this was a communication, a two-way communication. And that is extremely new. And the other side of that communication is objects that can be proved to be anomalous. So is science going to just sit on its hands still because they've always been wrong about this and now they have to change course? What do you think will happen culturally in science?
Yeah, I don't think they're going to be able to ignore this. I mean, those who really want to ignore it, they're going to ignore it no matter what you do. But we already have scientists asking us questions. Okay, can you give me more detail on this and more detail? So now don't forget, there is so much scientific data, detail that we can put in a film. After all, this is a film. It's not a PowerPoint presentation in a, in a scientific conference. So we put as much, also we want the average person to not be lost, with the science. So we showed enough evidence of the anomaly with some of the scientific explanation, but there's more detail. So we already are getting questions from scientists saying, yes, but can you tell us more? They're not saying it's CGI. They're not saying, because we have real legitimate scientists on the team. These guys aren't going to put their careers in jeopardy because of a film. In fact, that was a huge problem we had. So what I'm saying is that now we already have scientists looking at this, say, this does look anomalous. This does look very intriguing. Give us the details on the field of view on this and what was the angle, blah, blah, blah. So there's definitely some intrigue that's starting to happen. Now the film just got released 2 days ago. So, it's just the beginning, but I guarantee there's going to be a lot of questions, especially that our scientists are going to write the paper, which again is historical in itself. Right. And so I don't think they're going to be able to dismiss it. Now, you and I can agree that there's communication and this and that, but I think that's going to be a huge stretch for them. But where they're not going to be able to refute is that this is an anomalous event.
That's the all important thing, because it'll take time to, eventually someone will come sniffing along and say, what more can we learn from this? And then they will be looking at the object that was strangely cold and at the two cameras where one had the image and the other couldn't pick it up. And they'll get there, because that's the path. In other words, a path has been laid down. They're just at the beginning of the path. The beginning of the path is noticing the path. And that's where they are. And that's what that paper is going to help them do, is to notice that there is this path here. And where it's a many forked path, the great path of science. And where we will go with it, nobody knows. And probably just as well that they don't, because it's going to be a very exciting journey. Now, I would like to get on to another subject with you. I have regretted the fact that I have no ability to communicate with you outside of these moments. And this is it. I don't have, there are people between you and me in any case. The Close Encounter community always wonders, what do these things have to do with us? and how would we be studied? And there are answers to the second question, not the first. I'm going to talk about, and just give me a moment to talk precisely about how the close encounter experience can be brought into a scientific focus. It can be brought into a scientific focus by using functional MRI scanning to analyze brain function during the narration of close encounter memories. And the reason is that the brain assembles its production from imagined material differently.
Correct.
From the way it assembles its production from material that it perceived as a physical event. You get enough of these people together and interview enough of them under fMRI scans and have them repeat their narrative, eventually you will find a baseline that's factual. That could happen and could be done. Then we would know the factual basis of this experience. All of that said, do you sense that there's any connection between these objects and close encounters? I don't know if you do. Or did you have any indication? Did they seem to want to interact with you in any way?
Yeah, so I just want to make a comment on what you said earlier. Actually, there are people studying with fMRI and also other way of measuring the brainwaves, the difference between recalling a real experiment and imagining things. So there are studies being done and there are brains being scanned. And in fact, I mean, some groups, they haven't published anything officially, but they have located an area in the brain that seems to be very concentrated when a person is talking about an actual encounter. And so, excuse me. So it's going in that direction for sure. But what would be fascinating is also to correlate that was one idea that I was thinking about, is to have some sort of measuring device. There's different ways we can go about it while you're having, not just remembering something that happened, but yeah. And so that's something I'm investigating as well, because I definitely agree there is a connection. I had an experience recently, actually. I mean, all my life I had those experiences, but one particular experience I was at my house and all of a sudden I went outside and there's these three balls of light bouncing off of each other. And so, of course, my reaction was, is that it? Is that it? Yeah. Well, I'm just going to communicate. So I said, if there's intelligence behind this, you know, I could sense it, but I wanted that validation. I said, sure, you know, do something. So all of a sudden, the three balls become four, and then they become six, then they become eight. And then I was like, okay, cool. So you can hear me. Great. So then I said, well, follow me. So I started walking, you know, about half a mile, like in one direction. And they were like hovering, you know, above me in this one direction. Then I changed direction and I go in another direction. Same thing. They're like following me. I mean, what is that? Did I just make it up? Did I make this happen? I mean, if I did, I'd be like a super powerful person. I'd be like, superhuman for sure. But it was definitely communication. There was definite contact. Plus, I mean, I could feel it and see it and hear it. But, you know, this is physical evidence that this was happening. So now to answer the rest of your question, what do they want with us? I think some of them don't want anything. Some of them, it's like space tourism, you know, just like we would go to a different country just to check things out. You know, they're exploring space in this way. They don't really care. That's one part. Another part are very much, very much integrated with our story. And they want us to wake up. They want us giving us clues to know what to do next, to keep bringing out the truth, just like what we did in this film. The clues are ridiculous. Come on, you know? So that triggered me to make a film for people to see. For you, it's going to be another experience that's so obvious. You know what I mean? So they're gradually giving us more and more clues and tools to work with to bring about the truth of reality itself.
To find that truth is going to be an enormous human undertaking. It will be the greatest act of the human mind in history to get to the point where we are able to interact with this in a way that is meaningful and useful to us. We're not there yet. You have, on the one hand, a growing amount a number of indications that there is somebody here. On the other hand, you have the very confused close encounter narrative, which when I and my wife collected thousands of letters that we received after communion was published. And these letters were not all about abduction experiences, repeating the story in communion. It revealed a vast array of different types of experience. And now they're all collected at Rice University. So the archive is there. Yeah. And that archive is being studied by academics and beginning to be studied by academics. And so there's progress being made there. But I still believe that that the bodies of the close encounter witnesses are an important frontier. And how to address that frontier. Like, I have an implant in my ear that works and I use all the time as a research tool. What is it? We tried to get it out one time and it escaped and got, it's obviously a functional device. It went down into my earlobe and then went back up into my ear after into the top of my ear after the doctor quit, gave up. So there's that, and I'm not the only one like that. There's lots of people like that. I think the people are the next step, maybe for you.
Yeah, exactly. So I think that's exactly what you just said. It's for us to use these clues and tools to keep bringing out the truth from different angles, any which way we can. We are doing it. I think this is more truthful than the government coming out and telling us this, telling us that, which would be fantastic. But because it's the government, because there's agendas, because it's politics, it's also going to trigger a lot of fear, confusion. Are they lying to us? Are they hiding something? What's the agenda here? So
they never will tell you the whole story because they are constrained by the classification system to limit and edit everything they say, even in spite of the fact that the door may be as open as it can be, but you're not. You're right out there. This has got to come from the people, Caroline, and you've been touched, seriously touched by all those little orb experiences and so forth. You're being called and you're responding to the call. I think it's wonderful.
Yeah, I feel like I have to. Like, otherwise, sure. What am I doing? And I feel like it's really an organic experience for me that I'm speaking my truth. I'm not copying or, you know, I'm not like outside myself looking for stories to tell. So that makes a big difference. It feels it's an extension of who I am and what I'm here to do. It's that part makes it actually easy. What's not easy is, you know, the world, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because you're here to live your life, to follow your truth, follow your passion, no matter what it takes. It doesn't matter the outcome.
Well, exactly. Years ago, one of the visitors said to me, "We will come from within you." And I thought, oh God, what does that mean? Yeah. I know what it means now. It means this.
Yeah.
This is coming from within us.
Exactly.
This is what it's about.
Exactly.
Of course they want that. Back in back in 1977, D.B.H. Kuiper and Mark Morris, two astrophysicists, opined in Science magazine that the only reason someone would come here from another world, because of all of their vast knowledge that they would already possess, would be to find the new. And you find the new in us. We're what's new here. I can assure you that they've seen trees and animals and so forth of all kinds before, but they haven't seen what's in here before. And this would also be why they are so careful to avoid cultural colonization, which is what comes when the fancy British ship steams into the harbor on the primitive little island and begins to sell them pots and pans and knives. And all of a sudden, all of their gods fall asleep in their hearts, and their journey ends. Who is here is trying very hard to not cause our journey to end in the face of their superior abilities and technology. They are drawing us carefully forward, and you're the perfect person for it because you're so curious and you do it so well, and you won't quit. That's very important.
No,
you will not quit. I love it. It's great. A Tear in the Sky, folks, is it's a moment in history, because finally a show has been created that demonstrates to a level of scientific proof that these objects are there. These objects are there. Now, what is your best instinct as to what they are?
Yeah, I get that.
And you're guessing now. We understand we're allowing you to be a science fiction author for a minute and just guess.
Again, I think it's multiple things, not one thing. Some of the drone-like objects, I believe are human-made. And so they look like, they're doing crazy stuff, but all types of drones could be doing, like, there's drone technology that it's not stuff you buy off the shelf. I mean, these things can fly for hours and hours and do all sorts of strange maneuvers and things like that. And so
Grumman makes a drone that flies for 18 hours on electricity. That's right. Awesome. You have to know they've got some very special batteries that the public does not have.
Exactly. And they fly very high, and they could swarm, and, put a bunch of those, and it could look like, hey, there's something. So the drone type, I feel, are human technology. But like I said, some of the half organic ones are the ones that seem to have some sort of communication, like I was just describing. I feel it's extraterrestrial.
When you say organic, what do you mean by that word?
Well, sometimes you're communicating with a being, with a light. Like, again, it's one of those things. Can I prove it? How do I prove it? Like, you have to be inside my brain, inside my consciousness to get that part. But I am communicating. You are communicating. You hear a communication back. You see the communication. You say, hey, follow me this way. They follow you that way. How does that work? Did I make the object? I mean, that's crazy. Which is, like, for a scientist, which is a better hypothesis? That if I am communicating with an invisible thing other than the orbs, right? Because the orbs are visible to them, but they can't see the beings behind it, right? So which is more digestible, that I could be we could be telepathically communicating, or that I have so much power that I made the whole thing up and I'm making those lights appear and do whatever I want it to do? Like, what's going to baffle the scientists more? That's insane. Plus, there was a neighbor, actually. And I was like, do you see these things? And she was like, yeah, that's cool. Like, she didn't even register that how could this be or whatever. But I mean, like, there are other people watching, you know? So that's what I'm saying. Like science is going to have, I mean, they really, really are going to have to take a big leap to get to what's really going on. And so that's, yeah.
To see the bigger picture. Exactly. Reminds me of Monty Python's Life of Brian, the moment when the heir to the castle, his father, takes him to a window and says, "All this will be yours." And he replies, "What, the curtains?"
Yeah, exactly.
It's beyond the curtains, folks. They got to open the curtains and look out the window and see what's there. Carolyn, as always, it has been a great pleasure being with you. Can you tell us about anything about your next adventure? And I know there must be one in the offing.
Well, because of what we found and, you know, recorded in this last film, I mean, there's got to be the next one connected to what we did. Plus, we're trying to make it scientific, so repeatable. We want repeatable results. So I'm going to build on what we've captured, but also take it even to another level yet. So I'm already in the works on that. And so I'll be talking to you more about it as well. So yeah, but for now, focusing on ETHER in the sky, people need to see this. Like you're saying, it's historic. Yeah,
it is historic. That is exactly what it is, folks. It is historic. What has been done here is really very straightforward. They have taken highly advanced scientific instruments, scientists with excellent credentials, out into the night and detected UFOs without question at a very excellent and high level of scientific finish. It has been done. They are here. Who are they? That's the next question. And Caroline is going to answer it for us, if anybody can. Carolyn Corey, ETHER in the sky, thank you so much for spending some time with us on Dreamland. As always, I'm inspired. It was a wonderful show.
You're amazing too. Thank you so much for having me. It was such a pleasure. Thank you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.